Want to give a quick shout out to all of my patrons. Thank you so much for all of the continued support. Hey everybody, so this is the start of a new top 100 list that I'm going to do. I did this one about a year and a half ago and I want to update it because I've read so many wonderful books since then, but this is my top favorite fantasy novels of all time. Keep in mind, this is my personal list, not what I kind of think the masses think, so you're going to see a lot of stuff here that you probably wouldn't expect to see on your list or anybody else's list. I'm also going to try to keep these videos out weekly if I can, and they're going to be about 20 minutes each. So at the end of this, you should have a few hours of content, which will be cool if you want to watch me for a few hours, but shouldn't be any more than like 20 minutes or so. So let's start with number 100, and this is going to be Magician Apprentice. This is the first book in the Rift War saga by Raymond E. Feist, and it came out in 1982. This is a book that I was way late to reading. I ended up reading this last year. And I had a lot of bias going into it because I don't typically love books that have come out a long time ago. I don't know what it is, but something about those classic fantasy stories oftentimes just doesn't vibe with me the right way. But this one really, really did. For those of you that are not aware, in general, this story and this series is a very interesting hybrid of really classic fantasy, like Lord of the Rings type fantasy, very much like Lord of the Rings type fantasy, but also has a very interesting kind of sci-fi twist to it. And the twist being that there are two worlds, and there is rifts which connect the two worlds. So very early on in the first book, you find that a random rift has opened and these other beings are coming onto the planet and doing excursions, and they end up getting into quite the conflict. These aren't like aliens the way you'd think of them. Clearly they're aliens because they come from another planet, but they are humanoid, just an entirely different culture. And it's a very unique thing that I have certainly never read another book even since then that has explored the same topic, which is awesome. The really special thing about this book, aside from the fact that it is rather unique, both before and after this, at least from what I've found in popular fantasy, and I've read, you know, well over 500 fantasy books, so I certainly have a little bit of knowledge about what I'm talking about here. But beyond that, it's the story. You know, it follows this very classic tale where you have a very slow intro where it shows a young man or an older boy who is a very non-important person living in a castle in this medieval type setting. I'm sure you've read many, many, many stories that have followed a very similar similar story tropes, with a very obvious kind of love interest in the princess right at the beginning, that ends up big events happen and he's called to action because he is, you know, some sort of chosen one that has to go end up saving everything. And so you're reading it going like, oh, okay, yep, this is just one of those classic stories. But as you go along, so many of those classic tropes that you would come to expect end up getting subverted in a really positive way. And not just for the sake of subverting them, but because it makes the story so much better. I mean, it's got the classic things that you'd want to see in one of these old school fantasy stories with elves and dragons and magic and, you know, a wizened old wizard, you know, fighting an evil force that feels like there's no rhyme or reason to their actions, but just a source of evil. But all of them just have an amazing, amazing aspect to them. And as you get further into the series, beyond this book, you get to see that this other culture is not all evil, as of course it's not. And what I mean by of course it's not, I mean like, yeah, that's a good way to write things, because typically things aren't just inherently evil. There's two sides to things. But in a lot of these old school stories, you have, you know, Lord of the Rings type things with Sauron, which is just inherently, you know, evil embodied within itself, and there's no positive traits to it at all. You know, I personally enjoyed this story, you know, more than The Lord of the Rings. Now, I know that's blasphemous to almost everybody, but it's just what it is. I feel like if a lot of people just gave this book a chance and gave something like Lord of the Rings a chance, that a lot of people would pick this one without really knowing any kind of biases going into it. Now, the writing quality itself doesn't have that prose that Tolkien is so famous for. But the story beats themselves just had me riveted, and I ended up just falling in love with this. And I'm not quite through this series yet. At least this is an enormous series, but through the, you know, the mini series of the magician type books, and then there's other like mini series that go along, and I will definitely be writing those along for the journeying and seeing what those all are about, because I'm very excited about this series. So number 99 is Soldiers Live. This is the last book in the Black Company series by Glenn Cook. This came out in the year 2000. And this, I mean, I'm picking this book here knowing full well that even though I did love this book, it just did such a beautiful job at tying up this series. And it leaves me with all these really positive feelings of the series as a whole going into this, for all of the amazing ways that the story set itself up to be knocked out of the park with this final one. Now, I know that this kind of final book in the series is a little bit more controversial. Maybe it was more controversial when it came out, but the fact that I ended up reading this, you know, a couple decades after it came out, I think a lot of that cooled down. But I think there's a lot of mixed opinions on the later books in these series. I think a lot of people feel like it kind of lost its way, ended up kind of getting kind of out there in the topics that it was talking about. But for me, it's just such a wonderfully kind of perfect recap to this story. In general, the Black Company, and we're going to talk a little bit more about the Black Company later on in this video series. I don't remember exactly where. But the story follows a mercenary company that is called the Black Company. And they are taking money from the highest bidder. And oftentimes that's not necessarily a good person. But they're out there to get the money and to do their job. And they are fighting against, they have magicians inside of their troop, but they're not all magicians. They have a couple that are part of that. But they're, you know, grizzled veterans. And they are getting thrown into the mix. And pretty on in the story, things go a little sideways. And they end up getting tasked themselves with trying to figure out their roots. Because a very unique aspect to this whole series as a whole is the way that it's written. And I think it's one of the reasons that this series is so special for me and for so many people. And that it's not told in the narrative you would expect, where you have either the third-person perspective or even really the first-person perspective, even though it is first-person. But what it is it's like a diary. You have this character who's writing the book, who is called the Analyst. And the Analyst changes over time. And it's this person who is narrating things from their perspective and taking notes for the Black Company. And all of their biases go into it. And so it's really beautiful to be able to see such a drastic change as the books go along when you get a different analyst who has an entirely different worldview. It's really a masterclass in writing, and it shocks me at how perfectly the Glenn Cook was able to pull off this really difficult concept. Without spoiling anything, the troop, this company, ends up at some point a very long time ago losing their records, and they continue to take the records from this point forward, but they don't know where they came from. They don't know the history of them. They know the direction in the world that they kind of started out, or they think they started out, and so they end up migrating that way to try to figure out their history. And this is the book where it finally all comes together. You're waiting for it for so long, and nobody could predict what happens because it's incredibly inventive and surprising and a beautiful, poignant ending to this wonderful series. A lot of people have compared this series to Malazan, and I think those comparisons are fair. I think that a lot of the comparisons are out there because one of the authors of Malazan, Stephen Erickson, I think the author most people associate with it and who wrote the more popular of the books, Malazan Book of the Fallen, he credits Glenn Cook as a major inspiration for him when he was writing this series. And it comes out. I'd say that if you've read Malazan, the part that it comes out is the way that this company speaks to each other and gets along with each other as things like the Bridge Burners do, things like the Bone Hunters do, this group of veterans that love each other, that are fighting for the same thing, but they can get on each other's nerves. It's like this brotherly, sisterly sort of love that has the passion just ooze into it. It's really awesome to read. You know, it's almost like reading a Vietnam War kind of diary, even though it's in this fantasy old school kind of setting. Just wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. And stick to the series because it really goes in some really unexpected and really fun directions. All right, so number 98 is The Dragon Reborn. This is the third book in the Wheel of Time series by Robert Jordan. This was published in 1991. And I've kind of gone all over the place with where I personally kind of fell in love with Wheel of Time. Wheel of Time will, you know, I think always go down as a series that I have immense love for. It drops over time for me, not because I dislike it, but because I end up just reading things that I end up liking more than that. But I will always have a very positive impression of The Wheel of Time, and I suspect someday I might even reread it. But this is the book where I think I ended up saying, like, yeah, this is – I'm committed to the entire series now because of how much I like this one. The first two were very, I feel like, different from the rest of the series, and this one was like, okay, yeah, I get it now. I get where this different multi-POV thing is going. I'm invested in all these characters. I can't wait to see what happens next. And these big, larger-than-life moments are constantly happening that feel very earned and appreciated. And it feels like you've been waiting a long time for them to happen, even though we're only three books into a, I don't know, what is it, 15-book series? 16-book? Something like that. It's a very long series. But yeah, this is the one. And for a while, I thought of this as my favorite Wheel of Time book, but I ended up reading quite a bit more that I ended up liking that. So you're going to hear, you know, a decent amount of Wheel of Time on this list, but none of them really like close to the very, very, very top. I ended up getting a little bit – I also think that I was a little bit biased to like this one a little bit more because I found a bit of a spoiler about this series before I started reading it. A spoiler that in retrospect kind of feels very self-evident, but I realized who the Dragon Reborn was because I feel like if you don't know who it is, it can be a little bit ambiguous in the way that Robert Jordan writes it. Maybe not. Maybe everybody knows who it is and what it's supposed to be, and you look at the covers and it's kind of obvious, but I wasn't. I like to go in things very blind and ignorant of these sorts of things. And so I think I might have appreciated the first couple of books more if I didn't know that. But this is the one where it's like, okay, it's very obvious who it is now. And so I feel like I was able to appreciate it a lot more. I also have this amazing memory of the final scenes of this book. You know, there are certain scenes in books that will stick with me forever. I can just picture where I was when I was reading them, exactly what's going on. I'm just living in that world with them. And the last kind of like quarter of this book is one of those iconic moments for me and one of my favorite in the series. Just kind of everything kind of comes together. It feels like one of those Brandon Sanderson explosion moments where you have all these different kind of storylines feeding into each other. And it's just so well built out, so planned, and so perfect. And I will forever cherish this book and the ending of this book for all time. Moving on to number 97 is Assassin's Apprentice. This is the first book in the Realm of the Elderlings by Robin Hobb. This was published in 1995. And sort of like the last book we talked about, a lot of the feelings I have on this were about the feelings it gave me when I really fell in love with the series. Now, I happen to fall in love with this one very early on, within the first several pages. There's a lot of Realm of the Elderlings that I end up liking more than this one, but I always kind of harken back to this one as the one that made me fall in love with the series. And I'm so happy that it happened very early on, because this one can be a little bit harder for some people to read, because it's a very unique writing style. Now, I personally view Robin Hobb's writing style of this Realm of the Elderlings series as world-class and, quite frankly, the best of the best when it comes to writing characters. The series is split up into five different series. So you have four trilogies, and then you have one that is a four-book series. I think it's a tetralogy, I think is what you call it. I've heard people say different things, but I think tetralogy is the one that most people don't get upset when I say. But yeah, here you have this little boy, Fitz, who is a bastard, and he ends up getting to go move in with the king and the royal court. But he is not in the classic way as being trained up to be this big, powerful, you know, I'm going to take over the kingdom or have these crazy powers. It's a lot more subtle, and it plays this very against kind of the normal way that you would think that these books would go, and that he is a little boy that doesn't ever have the promise of being powerful. He has some skills, but he's going to be trained to be behind the scenes and be a support system to the people that are in charge, specifically his uncle, who's going to be in charge soon. And he's going to be trained up to be an assassin. Now, I find so many times in these older stories that you have a character that's being told they're going to be an assassin, and there's almost no assassinations in the story. And this is definitely, you know, the poster child for that sort of thing, because this is not an assassin story. There is a component to the story where he is getting assassin training from somebody. But what's really happening is you're finding out a relationship between the apprentice and the master assassin. That's the point that's out there. It's not because he's going to end up turning into some crazy assassin. No. This series as a whole, and even in this one, is a series about this character who keeps getting knocked down, and he keeps trying to figure out a way to pull himself back up again. And it's very difficult for him, and it's very difficult for the reader. I mean, you're going to be challenged as a reader at times to not cry, and not the happy cries, the very, very sad cries of pain and loss. And particularly if you've had things like loss and depression and things you've dealt with in your own life, you're going to see it portrayed here in a really masterful way. And that really, really nails it. And this one, you've got this moment towards the end of the book that you're never going to forget ever. And it's going to be seared into your memory banks for all time. But more than anything, you're going to have this character Fitz seared into your memory banks, because he's one of the most iconic, well-written characters of all time. And it all starts here, because what eventually ends up happening is you end up getting these 16 books, and Fitz isn't in all of them. He is in 9 of them, I believe. Its series kind of jumps around. It does some other things, but you get to see him grow up from this one as a little boy into the end of the series when he's like an old man. And that's an amazing experience. And being able to finish the series and then go back and look at where everything started, it's amazing. And it's one of those series where I'm sure that rereading it is a very powerful experience, and one that is immensely rewarding, because it's just being able to see all those things and where he ends up in his life and what changed him and why it changed him, and to be able to go through those moments that changed him are going to be very, very poignant. And I can't wait to do it someday. So yeah, check the series out if you haven't done it yet, but kind of strap in for some emotional distress that you're essentially signing yourself up for. Okay. So to something a little bit more happy, let's go to number 96, and this is The Umbral Storm. This is the first book in a new series, The Sharded Few by Alec Hudson. This came out in 2022. We have not gotten the second book in the series yet, and I'm heard that Alec has said that it's going to come out later this year, so I'm very much eagerly anticipating that. I think you're not going to find a ton of people that would have something like this on their list for a number of reasons. First, it's not very popular. I happened to hear about it on Reddit in the R Fantasy, because people were talking about how it's this amazing mix of epic fantasy and progression fantasy, two subgenres that I'm in love with. And so instantly I was sold. I reached out to the author, asked him if I could have a review copy. This is when I was a very small channel, and he very graciously said yes. I fell in love with it very instantly, because it is perfectly built like that. It is a long, huge, sprawling epic fantasy in the Brandon Sanderson kind of mold of fantasy, of modern fantasy. But it also has this amazing progression aspect to it. Now, you might not be familiar with the progression fantasy term. If you're a fan of my channel, you most certainly are, because I talk about it all the time. But the easiest way to describe it is kind of video gaming mechanics, where you have leveling up, powers that constantly get bigger and badder over time. And that constant progression of a character who gets stronger and stronger and stronger as it goes along, with not a lot of hiccups along the way. Maybe a little hiccup in one of the in a book, but he will most assuredly be ending the book in a much stronger position than where they started. It's a very addicting thing about reading these books, where it's that, oh man, just it's that kind of feeling of playing like Civilization, where you're like, oh, just one more turn, and then I'll go to sleep, and then before you know it, it's 4 a.m. and you have to go to work the next day, and you're going to be in pain. That's what it's like reading one of these progression fantasy books. This book it follows 3 different people that are all together in the same kind of location, and they are and end up finding these magical powers and ending up going on to the house that is responsible for those powers. So in part, the magic system here, there's these different houses along the map. I don't even know if that's the name of them, but I think it's houses that each have an aspect to magic to them. And you have like the shadow and the fire and the water, and they each have magical systems within that school that you can learn as you get more powerful along the way. When you get these shards, which is what the sharded few is all about. And as you collect them, you get more power and you get stronger and you get more magical powers as you go along. And you don't know exactly what you're going to get. Some are better than others. But the more you power up, the more you get these special powers. And in part, what I'm in love with about this series, other than the fact that it is epic, it's awesome and addicting, is the inventiveness that Al Cudson was able to pull off when he talks about the different powers that are in this book. Now, writing a magic system is not an easy thing to do. Or maybe it's too easy, because a lot of people just copy so many other things. Because for somebody not very inventive like me, it would be nigh impossible. And I'm always constantly impressed by authors, the Brandon Sandersons of the world, that are able to create this entirely new system that you feel like hasn't been done before and are able to do its own thing. It's like, man, you are so ingenious at being able to come up with these different concepts. And Al Cudson did this in a masterclass. I mean, he took things like a fire branch of powers, where clearly you already know everything that it could be, right? We've all played video games, we've all read books, we've all watched movies, we know all the different things you can do with fire, right? No, not at all. Because Hudson just continues to impress you with throwing out these new concepts that work, they make sense, they're fun, exciting, and it just got me going in a really, really, really fun way. And I cannot wait to keep reading on in the series and finding out where these characters end up, how these powers are going to manifest, what they're going to be able to get, how we're going to take down the bad guys, how we're going to get our side to win. Is our side even the good guys? So many fun aspects to this. Now, it's not the most complex writing in the world. It is very accessible and easy to pick up, but the action starts really quick and doesn't really let up along the way. It's one of those high-octane kind of books. And every now and then, I really, really like reading some of those when you can just kind of turn your brain off for a little bit and have some fun. And that's exactly what The Umbral Storm is. All right, so number 95 is Dragonfly Falling. This is the second book in the Shadows of the App series by Adrian Tchaikovsky, and this was published in 2009. So this is a series that I just started getting into. I've only read the first 2 books in the series, so hopefully it only goes up from here and I can start rocketing these things up my list. But Adrian Tchaikovsky is famous for, I don't know how famous, but relatively famous for his science fiction books. He is also famous for being a very prolific author. He comes out with books at a rapid pace. I mean, in the Sanderson mold of, I'm saying Sanderson on this video, I'm not meaning to, but in the Sanderson mold of coming out with multiple books a year kind of thing, and has really made it like his career to write a very large volume of books. But the first series that he wrote, I think it's his first, was this fantasy series, Shadows of the Apt. And gosh, what a good series this is. And it almost makes me disappointed that he didn't keep writing fantasy. Now, clearly he's found his niche and it's working for him. And I don't quite mind it, because I just read one of his sci-fi books, Children of Time, and I loved it, so I guess I can't be too upset about it. But God, this series is really, really good and inventive. In general, what the series is about is a a global conflict between races. Now, the races here are very unique and very inventive, because each of the different races here is a type of bug human hybrid. So you've got like the bee humans, you know, you've got the beetle humans, you've got the, you know, the dragonflies, you've got these different things, and they all can communicate the same, but they all have, they all look similar to their bug counterpart, but man-like and human-like. And they also have different kind of powers associated with it, not really magical powers, but things that make them either stronger or smarter or faster than their brethren. And they each have different locations on the map that mostly they are, that's the, where they're from. And some areas that are kind of a conglomeration of a bunch of different people together. And the, I think what this series is going to be about, because it's 10 books, I've only read two of them, things change. But I think what this whole series is about is the bee kin, I think it's kin or kindred, they are planning an invasion of a large majority of this map. And the people that are on the other side of that invasion don't really know it's coming. They're too trusting. The bee people are kind of doing in some faint, you know, reminiscing of kind of the way that Nazi Germany approached things in World War II, where it was a lot of posturing and people assuming that they wouldn't end up pulling the trigger, and them trying to kind of diplomatically take things over and set the stage. So when eventually they did, they were well prepared and everybody else was not. And by this time in the series, things have popped off. And I love so much, first of all, is the way that Shakovsky writes. He is a very, very masterful writer. His prose is a very wonderful mix of extremely well done, but also very accessible, which is great. It's hard to blend those two together sometimes. Oftentimes you find people just a little bit too far on one side or the other, but he really rides that line kind of perfectly. But I also find that the plot here and the fact of the sprawling epic where you've got these different point of view characters that are all going in different directions, it's doing that kind of Wheel of Time thing where you got people going off, merging to different groups, doing different things. This book has a amazing battle sequences. In particular, in this one, you have two very mighty sieges that I love sieges in books. And you get two of them. Well, that's great. Two for the price of one. It's just, it's awesome. I can't wait to see where the story goes. I'm in love with these characters. I'm in love with pretty much everything about this book. And yeah, can't wait to find out what the rest of the series is in store. And I'm pretty much sold on kind of reading all these things for how much I've liked the first two. Number 94 is The Shadow of the Gods. This is the first book in the Bloodsworn Saga series by John Gwen. This will eventually be a trilogy, but only two books have come out for it so far. Maybe four books in the series, but I think it's a trilogy. And this was published in 2021. It's one of the first books that I read in 2021, actually. I think. Maybe it was one of the last ones. Somewhere in that mix. I read it. But it's a... So I love John Gwen, first of all. John Gwen, I think, is more popular for writing The Faithful and the Fallen, which is a four-book series that was already completed by the time this was done. He also did a trilogy called Of Blood and Bone, which came out after that. And then he decided to leave The Banished Lands, which is the setting for those how many, four, seven books? I'm really bad at math. And then create a whole new series and an entirely different vibe to it, where in the first one you had the first kind of series, you had this kind of almost medieval England-y type feel to it. This one you have a fantasy, you know, Viking type of setting to it, which is awesome. I'm a big fan of Viking and Viking culture, and I've never read a fantasy book that kind of embraced that like this one. This one also does a really good job of making things a little bit darker and bleaker. It's certainly not a grim dark book, but it does have this dark vibe to it where you don't feel like everything's really going to work out. Or if it does, that a lot of the characters are going to go through major trauma and major problems, and they're probably not all going to make it out to the end of the series. It's just the vibe that you get. In this series, you have one of my favorite tropes in fantasy, which is not used enough, but you have gigantic, larger-than-life, kind of like fantasy beasts. And by larger-than-life, I mean the size of a building, You've got these gods that have died a long time before this series started, but you have people that are trying to bring them back to life. It follows multiple different points of view of characters that don't really get to mingle a lot with each other. It's kind of doing their own thing. You know where they're on the map. They do kind of cross paths a little bit, but they're all kind of telling a different story. I like that a lot, in part because I also like a lot of these characters. Now, you do get more point of views thrown into the second book here, but in the first one, I think you just get three of them, maybe four. I think three, though. And they're mostly people that you're rooting for. You've seen the different sides of this conflict. The stage is getting set. And things are popping off because John Gwynne can't write a book without making some craziness go on, because he, in my view, is the king of writing masterful battle sequences. And I think he knows that, and he likes writing that kind of thing because he really embraces it in this book, with some just really inventive ways at trying to finding any excuse to get these characters to get involved in some sort of large-scale skirmish so he can figure out a way to vividly describe it to you. And I can't figure out what it is that makes Gwen so perfect at this. Maybe if I was a better reviewer, I'd be able to kind of figure it out, but I'm one of those, I just talk about books while I'm finished, and I don't really put a lot of thinking into it. I just kind of like to get the words out. But I think the best way I could describe it is they're so well described in such vivid detail that everything makes sense to me. Everything is visualized perfectly. I have trouble visualizing some things in my book sometimes. I'm not one of those readers that can just like picture everything in a room perfectly. I need it described, and it's hard for me to remember certain things. And really every single little thing come to life. But the way he describes battles, I know everything that's going on. I feel like I'm there with the characters. I feel the stress and the trauma and the blood and the gore and everything, the emotions that are coming through all these characters and the battle plans and the betrayals, and you can see it all kind of coming to life. And it's wonderful. And some of his best are in this Bloodsworn Saga series. And the fact that this series has still been written, there's a lot of hype around this series. So no better time to get involved in this thing before the final book in the series comes out. Hopefully this year, but I suspect next year. All right, to number 93. And this is Empire of Silence. This is the first book in the Sun Eater series by Christopher Rocchio. This came out in 2019, and I have nothing but praise for every book in the series that I've read thus far. I've read five of them, three full-length books and two novellas and a short story collection. Not a big fan of short story collection, but I don't really like short stories, so I don't know that's anything against him. This series is a series written in this framing narrative, kind of in the vein of The Name of the Wind. I don't find connection. A lot of people say it's like a blend between Name of the Wind and other things and Dune or something. I don't really get those connections. The only thing that is Name of the Wind of this book is the way that the story's being told, and that you have somebody in the present time telling a story to somebody else, in this case, writing the story out, about the deeds of that character when they were younger. And I like that framing narrative a lot. I'm a sucker for it. I think a lot of people are. Because I don't even know why, because you'd think I'd hate it, because you get things ruined for you. Like, you know the character's going to be okay, because clearly they're alive by the end of the story. But I like the fact that they get to have their own spin on things and their own biases that go into the story. As they're telling it, I like that sort of unreliable narrator type thing that you inherently get in these framing narrative stories. And I also like the ability for the author to jump to the present every now and then, and talk about things in the present and then going back and telling that story in the past. It's a nice little device that's used. This series is oftentimes described as sci fantasy, where it's a healthy dose of science fiction and a healthy dose of fantasy, which is cool for somebody like me that is primarily a fantasy nerd, but also doesn't mind science fiction. And it's a really good way to get more into science fiction. And quite frankly, it has made me less resistant towards reading science fiction. And I'm finding a lot of science fiction that I end up liking. And I kind of credit The Sun Eater for kind of bridging that for me. So if you're looking for a way to get into science fiction from fantasy, this is a wonderful way to do it. The first book here is a little bit slower, and that it's doing a lot of buildup, where you have this character, Hadrian Marlowe, who is the son of a relatively important person in the universe, but not super important. Like, they're important on their planet, but not in the wider scheme of things. Because what's happening is, this is far in the future. It takes the humanity as we know it, but then way, 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 way forward into the future, when we have colonized the universe and gone off in a million different directions. You have different factions. You have, you know, a main central government. And as you can expect, you've got layers of bureaucracy that go up to the emperor of the universe, or whatever that title is. And so you've got this character that is not a big deal in the grand scheme of things, but has a lot of promise to do those things. And at the beginning of the story, within the first three pages, you find out that this character, Hadrian, is like the most notorious person of all time, because turns out that there has been a battle between the Cielsin, I think is the name of it, this alien race, and the humans, and the humans have won. And it's because of Hadrian. And Hadrian has essentially committed, I don't think it's genocide when it's an entire, it's more than just like a race. It's like planets and planets and planets and planets. There's a different word for the, like the genocide, but for a way, way bigger scale. And Hadrian's the reason for it. And he blew up a sun, which is where his title, The Sun Eater, comes from. So you get this really crazy backstory for who this character is and who they will become. But then you get to go back and find out the humble roots that they started, and you get to go along that journey with them. And the story starts before the alien invasion, so you kind of get to see things kind of popping off in this book. And by the end of it, you're so invested, and you're like, finally, you get that major feeling of like, okay, I get where this story's going now. And while that doesn't seem the most compelling reason to read the book, the writing here, the quality of writing that Rocchio is capable of putting out is a masterclass. I mean, he is a genius when it comes to the way that he writes his prose. It's incredible, legitimately incredible. And what makes it even more incredible, and he doesn't get bonus points for this because I think you need to grade things based on, you know, what you're reading at the time. But he was in his young 20s when he wrote this book. And it should not be possible for somebody to be that skilled at that age, because writing is one of those things that you get better at over time. It's not a sport, you know, where you cap out at a certain age. You get better and you get better and you get better. And I'm seeing that happen in real time as I'm reading his further books, and they get better and better and better. You're going to, you know, spoiler alert, you're going to see the other books in the series happen later in this video series. And it just boggles my mind and confounds me at how good he is, and where will he end up on the pantheon of fantasy writers when he finishes this series and he starts getting to an even better writer. It's not conceivable to me, but I can't wait to be along for the ride with Mr. Rocchio. Number 92 is Kelenved's Reach. This is the third book in the in one of the Molazin prequel stories. One of them, because Molazin has multiple prequel series. This one is called Path to Ascendancy. It's written by Ian C. Esselmont, and it was published in 2019. So Molazin, Book of the Fallen, everyone knows that it's written by Steven Erikson. Less people know, I mean, big Molazin fans do, but less people know that there's actually two authors Molazin. They don't write the same books, but they both created this world together as a Dungeons & Dragons-y type thing. I don't think it was Dungeons & Dragons, but it was that tabletop RPG type of thing when they were younger. And they ended up deciding, let's write some books. And Steven Erikson, you're going to write this series, and I'm going to write some other books along the way, telling different stories. This series tells the prequel story of the Molazin Empire itself. Now, Molazin, the world, is a real world with many different continents, tons of different cultures and races and people that with all these different political dynamics. The Molazin Empire is a part of that world, not an enormous part, a part. And when you're reading the series for the first time, it's showing that the Molazin Empire is young, and that they have not always been around, and a lot of mystery around how it came into power. Because when the first book starts in Molazin, Book of the Fallen, you've got in the prequel chapter, you have a takeover of one leader of the empire to the next. But that leader that got taken over, they founded the empire. And so this story tells this character and his best friend and his closest counselor, and how they together, from the most humble of humble roots, came to power, stole this empire, mashed it together, got the magical powers they needed to be able to pull this off, and ended up doing it. So in this third book, which is my favorite thus far in the series, there's five books, I think, out right now, maybe four, but I think it's five. Maybe four? Maybe five. I don't know. I'm bad with numbers. But this is the one where everything kind of feels similar. It feels like the stuff you know. In the first couple, it was a lot of, like, kids trying to figure things out. Very, very intro stories. But this one is like, oh, I know most of these characters already. These are the characters in the series. I get to meet them. I get to get their backstories. This is where they finally kind of start to run this empire. And things are moving along at a steady pace. And it's the one that got me really addicted to it. Now, I find a lot of these stories that are prequel stories that are throwing a lot of old characters in the backstories can be kind of fan servicey. It's like, the story didn't need to be written. I didn't need to know everything. Everything can be too convenient. And there is a small element of that, but I'm here for it. And I'm not always here for it when these other stories do it. I mean, I've had a lot of problems with other stories that have tried to do that sort of thing. I wasn't a big fan when Discworld did that. And they told the old story in the back in time version of the Night Watch. And many times that I felt like it's kind of fan servicey and didn't need it. But this one kind of feels like it did. It felt like in part because when I was reading the main Molazan series, Molazan Book of the Fallen, I constantly wondered, man, I sure wish I knew the prequel story. I'm desperate for it. And the fact that I got it and it's executed so well, and the Ian C. Elsamont is a very, very good writer that more people need to give credit and give him a chance, because there's an astronomical number of people that have read Steven Erikson and said, okay, I'm done with Book of the Fallen. I've heard not great things about this other author. I'm not even going to try it. Try it. You might fall in love with them like I have. And you're missing out on a whole different aspect to Molazan if you're not giving this one a chance like you did on Book of the Fallen. But don't read this one first. Definitely read Molazan Book of the Fallen first. All right, so number 91 is Orconomics. This is the first book in the Dark Prophet series by J. Zachary Pike. This was published in 2014. It is the winner of one of the Spiffbo competitions that Mark Lawrence puts together. It's a, self-published fantasy blog off, I think is the name of it. It's this competition where self-published authors can put their books forward. A lot of different book reviewers read them, rate them, and come with a winner. And Orconomics was the winner one year, one of the early years. And it's a wonderful book. It's so wonderful. I'm a big fan of Discworld. You're going to see some Discworld books on this list later on. And the reason I'm a big Discworld fan is for two major reasons. This is going to become relevant in a second, I promise, because I know this isn't a Discworld review. But I love Discworld because, first of all, it's funny. I like to laugh. I'm a big comedy movie fan. I try to be a jokester in my real life. I like to be around people that are similar, that they like to laugh. They like to have a good time. They like to joke around. It's one of the things that made me fall in love with my wife. It's one of the many things that makes me love my children, is they're constantly trying to make me laugh. And the other thing that makes me in love with Discworld books is the very poignant satire that it does, where it takes this really funny kind of background, but very like deeper themes to it. And these interesting satirical remarks on modern things and a fantasy setting. Now, both of those things that I love about Discworld were done to perfection in this Dark Prophet series, particularly in the first book, Orconomics. I found each of the books to get a little bit worse. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't read them, because I still liked them. But the first book is where it's at. The first book is downright hilarious. It's one of the funniest books that I've ever read. It's funnier than most Discworld books to me, almost all the Discworld books. It is... And I'm not using this with hyperbole. It is laugh out loud funny. I mean, there were moments in this book, one in particular, a whole sequence of events where I was like having trouble breathing. I was laughing so hard out loud. And my wife, who was like watching TV at the time, was like asking me if I'm okay and why am I laughing at a book? It's so well done. I mean, this book is a satire of the banking industry, which is a really fun thing to kind of do. And it's involves this Dungeons and Dragons-y team of adventurers that come together that end up having to go solve a quest. And that's really what the book's about. You have these classic characters that are perfect for a fantasy setting. You got your warrior, you got your bard who doesn't want to be called a bard. You've got a dwarf. You've got all these different things that you would want to see in a Dungeons and Dragons party. But the way they get along with each other and the humor that just constantly flies at a lightning pace. I mean, the jokes come at you like one of those old, like, Naked Gun movies or Airplane movies, where it's like, we're going to try to shotgun so many jokes at you. And even though not everyone's going to stick, at least for that particular person that's watching it, enough of them will that you're going to be laughing the whole time. And that's what this one did. It's every page is trying to throw something at you that's comedic. And maybe some of it flew over my head. Maybe there's more that, like, is out there funny that I'll get on a reread. Hopefully, because I will definitely reread this at some point. But if you're looking to laugh, you're looking to have a good time, if you're a Discworld fan, do yourself a favor, check out Orchonomics, check out this whole trilogy. The last book came out last year, so the trilogy is all done. If you're one of those people that doesn't want to get involved in a series that have been burned by, like, George R. R. Martin before, because you want to get the last book in a series, this one does exist. Try it out, have a good time, you'll love it. So that is the first 10 for me. I think I went way over 20 minutes. Oops. So I guess this is going to be a very long video series because I'm kind of committed to now doing each of these videos about the same length. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. But so that's my 10. Stay tuned next week. Hopefully next week. I'm going to try to do this on a weekly basis. And go Niners in the Super Bowl today. So hopefully that goes well. I will be crying a lot of tears no matter what happens in that game. Either really happy, grown man tears for winning, or like really, really sad, like little baby tears for losing. But either way, a lot of waterworks coming out of me. A lot of the waterworks coming out of my face. And let's just hope for the best. Come on, Niners. All right. Thank you so much for watching this way too long video. If you've stayed here this long, kudos to you. Thanks so much. And as always, happy reading to you. Thanks again to all my patrons, with a special shout out to my Ascendant tier and Librarian tier patrons: Anna G, CJ, Doust, Darren, Gregory, Jonathan, Nathan T, Nev's Book Channel, Orthodoxia, Ron Reich, Russell, Ryan L, Sydney Baker, Tay C, Tahir, Anna, Andra, Blair, Brock, Evan, Fanixan, Harry B, Joe, Cat Mick, Michael Sugarman, Philippe, Sky, TW57, Wacky, and Zion. Thanks for sticking to the end of this video, and if you want to watch some more content from my channel, click over here and I've got some good videos for you. Thanks so much.